No, don't
start again, Mari. That's enough. I can't have a paranoid person working with me. It's over. I'm firing you.
You're firing me?
Today's highlight.
And the change of government? Won't stop a thing. I've run out of fingers counting the number of multinationals setting up here.
What about the three companies that announced their plans to launch last week?
I say they're shortly. Me, I'd be looking to sell.
At what price?
More. Much, much more.
I don't know who you are or how you know these things, but one thing I'm sure of, you're in the wrong job. Here, call me tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning. I'd like to hear more from you.
Are you ready for your big break? The East African, understanding the region.
The sign will read, auditions for Fridays have been canceled. I'm sure no one will show up because I myself won't be there. Welcome to the show. My name is Brian Mlondo, and I'm telling you, I'm feeling good. Today, if you're a lover of cars, it's your day. I will be some awesome Beamers. A look at sports, the news, and of course, what's making headlines in the daily. And don't forget, the big story with Joel Senyonyi, all here on Morning at NTV. Let's get underway as usual with your question of the day. Morning is nice. Click the button like one of us to follow some of your favorite presenters like Joe.
You're watching at Simon Abel Cape.
Again, a very warm welcome to Morning at NTV, coming to you live from the Kampala International Conference Center. And my name is Brian Mlondo. This morning, President Yoweri Museveni has described the new Prime Minister, Dr. Ruhakana Rugunda, as a disciplined cadre who actually never complained, even when junior cadres were given positions that were more senior. The President made remarks while overseeing Dr. Rugunda's swearing-in earlier on Thursday at the State House in Entebbe. Dr. Rugunda, the immediate former health minister, also becomes the leader of government.
People to come and feel good here. You must bring here people who are relevant. Not people who are coming to just be with you.
The MPs spares money, whether for Ugandans all over, all subject to audit by the Auditor General and Uganda.
How can a project on accountability not be audited? How?
Really?
Because you cannot have a big project in the name of Ugandans. And you don't want anybody to know what is happening with it.
Okay, we come and explain our position, why this is a unique project.
But a source in the judiciary who prefer to remain anonymous said, since the Prime Minister's saga in which donor funds were swindled, has now preferred using their auditors to monitor their funds put into various projects in the country instead of waiting for post-mortem reports of the Auditor General.
The person who should who should own those audits, Auditor General.
The other time when donor funds were stolen in the OPM, someone asked us to refund their money.
Jingo Francis, NTV Parliament.
Now MP the 2% bills and returned the He said these are the proposals for taxes which are expected but are needed to finance this year's budget. Majority of these think that the president is being very unfair, especially with the excise duty bill, which has a proposal for a 200 of kerosene and power. That the bills were re-scrutinized by Parliament's Finance Committee. We have a report.
Another 4 hours.
Too many rural Ugandans, kerosene is considered one of the most important items, a necessity when it comes to lighting. The finance minister, while announcing this year's financial budget in June, proposed a 200 shillings tax, but this was flatly rejected by Parliament when it came up for debate and adoption. This week, the president informing the speaker, Rebecca Kadaga, that he was returning the three bills for consideration, and key among them was the bill contained a proposal on the 200 shillings tax on kerosene.
The 200 shillings was supposed to go through, was supposed to go towards the funding of the project for the villages. Start a project for lighting in the villages.
Wanga, who also sits in the budget committee, says they will scrutinize the bills again. But to some lawmakers, the tax is, and they say the proposal will be rejected again when it returns to the floor of Parliament.
Unacceptable is to continue to tax kerosene. I would advise the president that his clemency should reign.
The people who are paying this tax of kerosene are the already poor. For heaven's sake, can't we just be sympathetic to the poor?
Some MPs think the president in not going along with Parliament's decision because the proposed taxes will contribute greatly to the budget.
So that we help in the villages get some lighting, solar lighting. Now, that was ignored. And as I was president, I would have sent it back.
Consider it to the people of the grassroots. But if the president brings it in the floor of Parliament, we as parliamentarians should debate it accordingly.
The Constitution says that where the president returns the same bill twice and the bill is passed for the third time, with the same support of at least two-thirds of all members of Parliament, the bill shall become a law without assent of the president.
Therefore, if the president is interested in helping the country, he should first avail electricity to each adult.
Maurice Ochol, NTV at Parliament.
Now, on the news this morning, has been steadily improving over the years to about 70%. Superstitions and cultural beliefs still. In Karamoja, latrine coverage is at about 5%, according to figures. Health workers are now using a new approach of exposing residents to eat near feces to discourage them from open defecation. Kenya reports NGOs in the water and sanitation sector are calling for more funding and investment in the sector to change such trends.
A trek through Kanamokol village in Adunget sub-county just outside Moroto town. What you see littering the ground is actually human excreta. The areas where residents practice open defecation in the region.
For us, she has sung that issue of people cleaning the compound, cleaning their homes, not defecating around the water source. She's now tired responding.
Most people in Karamoja believe they are too poor to construct latrines in their homes. Karamoja, about 400 residents. It is only Teko Nakiro, the village health team member, who has a latrine. The rest is themselves about 300 meters nearby. The elders claim the children are responsible for the feces here. There is also a cultural belief here that a mother-in-law share a latrine with her son-in-law.
The belief is that when these things met, the waste matters meet inside the latrine, then that becomes a bad omen.
They have the complaint of they don't have food for them to eat, to give them energy to dig latrines, and then the other thing they are talking about, they don't have the local materials.
The leader's main concern is out of mindset of the community. One approach that was used with funding from the district water grant is community-led total sanitation, CLTS. The approach was used in Koititi and Kaingolajek villages in Lotome sub-county district. It is a way of triggering residents to abandon a practice by exposing them to it and letting them feel the negative effect. For instance, health workers can put a piece of bread close to some feces and challenge someone to eat it.
We make them to open
one bottle which was not opened, and they took that water. Then we opened, we told them also to open. Then we just put a thread and to touch fizzes, and we put inside there. They refused. People started looking for ways to improve this village.
As of last year, the county was having a latrine coverage of just 3%.
For a long time, these communities over here have been easing themselves in the bushes surrounding this place. But since the beginning of this year, they have migrated from the practice to this one. This is the 39th latrine they have for about 45 households here. The benefits are enormous.
After we're told feces are dangerous, we make sure we use the latrine every time.
Even children used to eat themselves in the compound. Because we were taught that all feces are dangerous, even that of children, we now drop in the pit latrine.
A village like this one, we started, has even never reported a case of hepatitis because they have stood to the test of saying that feces, whether the one of children, whether the one of what, should be in the latrine.
Leaders from the region have found it difficult to stop people defecating in the open, been helped by the lack of a binding legislation or bylaws.
We think that if these ordinances are passed by the council and enforced, they will go a long way to transform these communities.
It is hoped that the situation will improve with time, especially if local leaders and the village health teams work hard to change the mindset of the community.
I believe with the time, even in this area here, things will change. Given the fact that you have VHTs here, much as VHTs is a bit not really motivated in terms of from the members.
If we spoke from the village level up to the district and the national level, then the chances that our people will respond are very high.
Experience has shown that the community-led action is one of the most suitable ways of mindset here. The problem that dogs this initiative is limited funding.
So the ripple down effects are huge. If, for example, there's no money to provide adequate sanitation to the communities, people will continue in open defecation.
A place like Karamoja has been seen to be left in many aspects because of the history we've given.
Increase this grant to reach to levels that can help us to do more CLTS work. It will serve us good.
Following years of the new approach, leaders hope that it will be replicated in villages like Kanamokol to improve sanitation, clean and hygienic environment that benefits everyone. Moses Akena, NTV.
You're watching Morning TV, and you can follow those stories on our Facebook page, but also on our YouTube channel, that is NTV Uganda. Also go to our website, ntv.co.ug, and watch. And have you downloaded the new mobile app, that is NTV Mobi, where you can catch this show from wherever you are, whether in your home, in your office, stuck in, still catch live. And as we celebrate 8 years, we're giving back to you. Next 100 days, we'll be giving out a motorbike every day, plus 8 gift hampers. And at 6 o'clock, Robin Kisti will be... This code you see up here, yes, send it to quadruple 6. And good luck to all of you. Coming up, we're going to look at what's making headlines in the Daily Monitor and The Observer this Friday morning. Once again, a very good morning to you. It is the third day of October, Friday. And as clearly judging from Kasiate's dress code, it's a Friday. Jeans, yeah. So what would you apply here?
I don't know. Give me one.
Yesterday we learned tempestuous. Mm. So today, so we've made it a ritual. We need to learn
one. So many days ago, you were learning tempestuous.
I was what learned did you? You taught us something else. Yeah, I've forgotten. So teach us something else.
I don't know, maybe a related word. Tumultuous.
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 It comes from the word tumult. A tumult is very loud noise. Mm-hmm. Very, very loud noise. So
tumultuous situation is a very noisy one. It could be guns or rioters, like these friends of mine who are displaying pigs or that kind of thing. That's a tumultuous situation arising from a tumult.
Okay.
Isn't that tumultuous?
From somebody, that is tumultuous.
You remember when our friend Tika Simire said, what did he call it? A kleptocracy or something. He was talking about a kleptocracy, which is a state and stuff like that. But yeah.
Uganda National Examinations Board, counting down to less than a month for first set of examinations going in for primary leaving, is reported to be broke, and that is our headline story in the morning. And yes, they need some 6 years in less than a month to go.
Wow.
They say if this man is not availed, they will do their exams. Of course, PLE is upcoming, UCE for all level, USCE, and all that might stall. Because the issue is actually examiners, and that's the challenge there was last year. Examiners were not paid, so marking delayed and releasing of results and so on.
Mm. But what could be the challenge here? We know that examinations come in at a certain particular time in the year. Students have prepared themselves for 7 years and 2 years, respectively, but across the three levels, at least for secondary school, not forgetting other forms of examinations that are superintended over by UNEB. And how can you say that they, as a government body, plan effectively for this crunch time and find themselves in need of 6 billion?
That's how we do things, unfortunately. We never plan. That's why we'll plant trees 2 weeks to Chogam. That is why money, UPE money, will be released at the end of the term. You know, and the teachers were saying, now you're giving us this money when the term is very useless. It's like giving you food without salt, and then after you've eaten it, I give you a salt
to find the food there. And this is very, very sad, you know. On the 14th?
Third and fourth of
Let the parents who have children at that level tell us.
No, is your child that? No.
I am a board member of a primary
school. Third and fourth, that's what, P7.
And yesterday we had a very serious management meeting at St. Kitts Primary School in Bukoloni, where we are deliberating, among other things, how to close there. And of course,
and how to increase teachers' pay.
There is that also as well, and how to discipline errant teachers as well as motivate those who are still.
How do you deal with errant board members?
Let us say that we are not going to discuss the details of our board meetings on air, but certainly.
But, okay, so P7, when is P7?
3rd and 4th of November.
Of November. And you see, this is very, very sad. I was talking to a friend of mine who, you know, is working in the UNEB, and they seem to. Me, I'd like to compare UNEB to FIFA. They should be in a position where, regardless of what is going on, FIFA must make sure the World Cup happens.
Yeah, but you see, FIFA has a bit of autonomy. I'm not so much into sports, but I know that it has a bit of autonomy.
This should be the only thing that should not be compromised. Exams.
Well, that like many other things, if healthcare.
Let them steal money from the office of the Prime Minister. We have accepted.
Money made for Northern Uganda.
Yeah, we have grown to kind of, you know, some of us are even growing hardcore. Like if we hear 10 billion has been stolen, we are not.
You have
more.
Become petrified.
We are like, okay. But exams, it's a shame.
Well,
a shame.
The new Prime Minister, right honourable, you call him now, David Livingstone, Rwakanda Rugunda, was sworn in yesterday at State House. Reported here in the Daily Monitor, President Museveni at that function did describe Dr. Rwakanda Rugunda as a very disciplined cadre who doesn't grumble even when he is placed under the supervision of more junior persons in the army, drawing parallels between between Rugunda and his own father, the late Amos Kaguta, who he said he was my senior, and squatted here in the Daily Monitor, but when I became president, he allowed me to be.
It's interesting how these gentlemen are subtly throwing jabs at each other. You know, the other day as they were debating before they approved Rugunda in parliament, said that, look, when President Museveni was, I think, in New York, for us who were here on ground and Rugunda helped us a great deal, he was sending a message of, look, you other people were having fun, for us who are here in the trenches. Now, of course, the president says, Rugunda is one of those that don't grumble when they are reshuffled and, you know, an exchange that might go on for a bit.
Well, the president in the African leaders are backward.
I agree. I don't agree with His Excellency the President on many fronts, but that one I totally agree. Kumbe, he's a European leader.
I don't know which country he leads, but he says one of the reasons you know a country is backward is when most of the population is still in the agriculture sector.
Is still or is in backward agriculture sector? Because
in
you
fact,
see,
backward.
Because you see, there is agriculture like the one practiced in Denmark, the one you used to study about, the one you used to study about in the prairies and you know, the Andes Mountains and the like. That cannot be regarded as primitive. I mean, President George W. Bush, former president of the USA, is currently on his farm in Texas. You cannot regard him as a very backward guy. So perhaps he's took the kind of agriculture like the one we practice here in Uganda, which is heavily subsistence, not mechanized, where people are still using the hand hoe.
Now, the president also goes on, said that sometimes he has trouble explaining to some backward ministers. Now, I do not know why you appoint a backward minister.
But you see, he's speaking from a pool of, you know... If you're in a pool of available people and the available people are backward, it means that he's picking a one-eyed guy out of a bunch of blind people.
No, I don't agree.
If you're a team leader, Simon, me before everyone, because as far as I'm concerned, I am the cream de la cream. You'd have chosen anyone, but I think...
But you see, even away from that, you see, our country is not a made first run dead. Into exile and that
All
kind
of them
thing.
Are dead, actually.
Well, I think the last one was alive.
I'm sure. if protesters turn themselves into police, I am constrained to even give these characters a bit of mention because perhaps that's what they are actually looking out for. Otherwise, what would explain their actions? But well, the menace in the city, the guys who go around throwing pigs on the streets, some of them have now turned themselves into the police, and we hope that the police can and try to regard some of those dictates in the penal code of, you know, trying to press hard and find out exactly what motivates these young people beyond considered to be jobless.
I'll tell you, yesterday I did say that, you see, I don't like it when the city is disorganized, you're trying to maneuver going somewhere and then there's have your piglets and stuff. I think it's a very disturbing thing. However, I'll tell you, I'm increasingly beginning to support these young people. They are trying to attract the attention of the powers that be, because you see, look, our leaders are now concerned about themselves as opposed to about the general population. They spend
a lot better. Well, your favorite magazine every Friday, the Daily Monitor, comes up with Scoop, and this morning they are talking about just in Kampala. There's a huge concert whose tickets have run out for over a week that's going to take place right behind ourselves here this evening. A concert that I would have very much loved to attend, and I am making a passionate on-air appeal for anyone that has got a pair of tickets. I don't care whether they are for Chirasha or on top of the building, but kindly pass them on to me. Your reward will be kept with St. Peter in heaven.
Someone said that, well, my channel wants me to take her out for the jazz concert. Me, I'll wait for login. I'll be there live.
You said you would go to hell and back for her. Before you married her, so.
Yeah, well, so if you're interested in the showbiz industry and, of course, getting to know a bit of 411 with regard to some of these people that make it the list that you call celebrity list, the Scoop magazine is usually one of those items in the Daily Monitor that you don't miss every Friday morning.
Kasate, are you a celebrity? I'm a common banana. As I buy movies of 2K, Suriyad. I real celeb writes in the Observer this morning, said color to your suits, metrosexual magazine.
Especially so, if you're a celeb, you see them wearing red suits, I don't know, green so white, pastas. Yeah. And
I'm not wearing a suit today, I'm on a writing.
Let me ask you something. Just the other day, I was talking to someone about corduroy pants. They're out of vogue, right?
No, corduroy? It is tiny.
That, when you see a man dressed in a corduroy pant, then you know they are not in touch with their style.
I wouldn't agree with you again, father, because I have a couple of corduroy pants at home and about five.
When do you wear them?
I wear them when I'm. Well, I promise. I am going to wear my greenish blue.
You have a green
corduroy pant on Friday.
On Friday next week.
On Friday next week.
Corduroy pants?
Yes, but I have to sneak into it and sneak out of the house because my my dear wife thinks that when I wear that pant, I remind her of long demised ancestors. Not even just relatives, because clearly,
yes,
if you saw
yesterday. I've always known corduroy pants for, like, you know, ancestors.
And interestingly, I have exactly this corduroy suit that has got even a patch right here. But, you know, wearing it becomes a challenge because then if you wear it, you're not going to move with somebody.
Yes.
But they are really nice. I like the material. It's one of the pieces of clothes that you are sure will certainly not degenerate. Even if you sit on a nail, you need to be...
In a wash and wear.
I see one of our cameraman is wearing road jacket.
And he loves that particular
jacket. Yeah, he loves that car jacket.
Tomorrow we shall make you a celeb.
And since we brought up international news and talking about cameramen, we are told from international news that an American camera person in Liberia has now been confirmed to have contracted the Ebola virus and is said to be flown back home. Yet residents in Dallas are, you know, chickened up that there is one of them who just returned from the West African part of the world with Ebola and is under quarantine. Yet the government of the U.S. and health officials are reassuring them that nothing can defeat the U.S., not even Ebola.
Wow. Actually, the reassurance is, you see, when he returned, of course, he had contact with his children. Mm. Now, the children went to schools, four different schools that they belong to. Mm-hmm. And now they are thinking, even though it might be far-fetched, these children might have spread it to the others. But they're trying to sanitize the schools and so on to make sure that they avert the situation.
But you know, what I've also realized, Americans do not know where actually Ebola virus is. Most of them, I know, I think there were two artists that canceled concerts in Uganda saying there's Ebola. And you're thinking,
they're paranoid.
Yeah, do you even know where these are? But yeah. Well, you can check out the Observer, the Daily Monitor, and the Red Pepper, which has been and grab yourself a copy. Morning at NTV continues with the big story. Stay with us.
You're watching at NTV with Simon Mate, Mabel KB Runji, and Brian Do.
Babe, you know a true angel.
Aww.
I love your walk, your smile, your laugh, everything. You know what else, babe?
What?
You smell. Oh no, I'm out of airtime. Shops are closed. I have to wait till tomorrow before I can get airtime. Ah, she would think I was saying she smells.
Get airtime instantly with your phone.
What?
Just use Airtel Money. Dial *185#, select buy airtime, and follow the steps.
What?
Sorry, babe. My line got cut. I was just saying you smell better than any flower in the world.
Top up with Airtel Money and get 100% bonus airtime instantly with every top up made. Now, that's 100% extra from Airtel. Dial *185# to top up now.
Airtel Money. Simple, secure, instant.
Musajja avubuka naddamu n'avubuka wakati awo n'avubuka mwana ng'avubuka buwanvu
abawala bagamba kishee twagala okufumbirwa naye bagaayo abo tebali serious
omusajja n'omukazi banabanga omuto
kakati awo
so omusajja n'abakazi
awulirisha ng'ate tulimero nyingi
onkoze bubi nti tosoma kutuuka soma tutuuke ku lwomukaaga
tuolo n'agamba and he says for that cause a man shall leave his mother and shall cleave to his wife and they shall be one flesh
neewubye nnyo gyobulubuzi lwaki lukyalabika
osanze ngenda kumpewo nkulange wonna
nti rukiya nabumpingi
kanyumira nyaka
ne bagamba nti aa telex free yakutteyo n'oteekamu sente
Eri kikyaye buwaza bwana abantu n'obusente bwabwe obutono baagoba ddiiru
bwatuuka ku Biafra stadium waaliwo eppipa n'agirinnya n'abagamba nti nno mubadde mugandi mwagala kuwuliza mimi
education is the one ngogulawa tonoza ti you can't have every key opening everywhere so you must be
Aro, give me 5 stress, 3 gonorrhea.
Kare muri wano, you think you've brought carpassers? Omwana ye naso wolo gamba super deep. Simi akaja fre.
I'm like, I like my swag too.
So what about it? That's what like, I also like your accent.
Now, when you political
why are you crying?
I think I'm Big Mitch. Larry Hoover. Put that in Kiprotich's accent.
I think I'm Big Mitch. Larry Hoover.
at NTV with Simon Kassia, Mabel KB Runji, and Ndo.
A very good morning once again, and welcome to the big story section of Morning at NTV. My name is Simon Kasiati. Today, we are looking at the celebration by the police capping their 100 years existence. We are told the tagline for the celebration, rightly so, is from colonial to community police. We are told that, of course, today's police has become more pro-people, is accountable, and a disciplined force with modern capabilities to deal with increasingly modern-day crime. That is what we'll be mooring over when we return for the big story. John and I are seated here in the comfort of our round table outside the Serena Conference Center to have this candid discussion of what we feel is the achievement of the police 100 years down the road. Let's not forget that Uganda has only been independent for 52 years in the next couple of days, 6 days to be very exact. But before our independence, there was the police. The police was there before the modern state of Uganda as we know it. And it was charged with the responsibility of protecting citizens across. But prior to our independence, the police was the colonial police. And the colonial police was out to entrench further the colonial government to ensure that they beat the natives into shape so that the colonial masters can superintend over them without any much hassle. Many years down the road, 100 to be very exact, the police seems to be assuming more the moniker of a community police as opposed to a colonial police. They're celebrating 100 years. But if we look at what the police has been for the most part in recent history, is it just a change of name or it is actually an actual change worth a mention? We are not bringing in a policeman to discuss police issues. After all, don't we all interface with the police on a daily? So today, I've got a guy that has been in and out of police institutions and interactions.
Yeah, going Joel to interact with them and interview them.
Good morning, Joel. And,
good morning.
Yes, the police is celebrating 100 years. You've had tremendous interactions with the police. I do not know whether you ever spent a night in a police cell or gone to visit somebody, or ever sought police help when you have been robbed, or ever been flagged down by a police officer to check whether you have all the documents that are right. What is your general take on this hype and celebration of over the 100 years of their existence?
Let me begin by cutting the police some slack. I'm giving them some kudos. You know, just like when a nurse is going to inject you, they pamper you a little bit because and make you feel nice.
Since
and
when did you start being kind to persons like the police or government?
The police force, I think a good number of them are trying. I've encountered a number of police officers who will be, you know, when you're in a situation where there is a need for them, mm-hmm. and they come through for you. Some of them try as much as possible to be professional, etc., etc., and it's a good thing, and I hope we can see many more of those. By and large, I liked your anecdote of, you see, in the colonial times, the police was in place to, if you like, make
to
sure...
police, that, really. I, like the name says, to...
Yeah, to beat them into, to make sure that, you know, the population falls in rank and makes sure...
Is subservient colonial subjugation.
I like to think this current police seems to be slowly but surely going down that drain. And that is why you see, you know,
we
the
whole,
you know, Kaihura. Well, in this case, not to colonial masters, but you see, to the powers that be, to this particular NRM government, as opposed to the state and you and I. Mm. And that is why you see a whole investigating who is trying to poach which seat within the NRM, and you're thinking, wait a minute, that sounds not like a criminal matter. And so there is a lot of mistrust for the police. Even for those that are doing a good job, much of the time, they are stained by the general picture of mistrust, and that is why people feel this police is a total letdown. Even when, by the way, for example, they will go to quell a riot and they'll try and use as reasonable force as possible, people will not cut them any slack. Why? There is mistrust, something that needs to be dealt with.
But I also think that the police has done tremendously well in the face of the changing way of and also the militancy in demonstrations, for that matter. I mean, I have my good old friend Ruweza, with whom we studied and lived in the same dormitory. Just my bed was next to his. And, then when we were students, Ruweza was one of those very quiet but mischievous guys that, you know, at a very personal level, guy. But he's faced with a militant populace in Kampala, to be very exact, one where, for example, demonstrations And they are not just demonstrating like the ones we see occupying Hong Kong squares and all that, who are told, please, you can assemble here, but please not go beyond this barricade. And they will, you know, and the demonstrators are having logical discussions and they have certain legitimate demands. But here you just have guys herding pigs on the street and all that. How are you able to control such a populace without being a little bit harsh? Because after all, Newton's third law of motion says for every action,
there always has to be
an equal but reaction.
I'll tell you, much of the time the police find themselves in a catch-22 kind of situation of what do we do here? And sometimes I empathize with them. Often to quell the riots in the market. You see guys, you know, at the top of the buildings, hitting the police with stones, you know, and you're thinking, no, this is not right. Surely if a police officer shoots you at that point in time, quote-unquote right. Sometimes I think the public out there is a little bit vitriolic in the way they exercise their rights of protesting and that kind of thing. But you see, oftentimes than not, you look at the police, the way they handle some of these rioters and protesters. Sometimes they even fetch them. There's a time Black Monday activists were in the enclosure. These guys were not in the streets, for goodness sake. They were within, you know, a certain confined area. They just had the press with them. But police had to come in, tear away their placards and so on. They're thinking, that's for. And again, often when you see the police arresting these people, they are going with whoever it is they've arrested. You know, this person is not even resisting arrest, but you're clobbering them under that truck. You continue to beat them.
People do not resist arrest here.
Well, there are some who do.
Especially if there is a camera person around.
There are some who do. Absolutely. But you see, look at a particular scene.
Let's move it away from the police's action towards the public. Let's look at the police itself internally. I mean, these are men who, for various reasons, chose to join this vocation and ostensibly to work for the country. And of course, they know that 100 years ago, a police officer was a highly respected person in society. They had accommodation paid for by the state. They, in fact, were also fed. They were clothed. Yes, we see currently the current police has a tremendous line factory up and ready to work. But let's look at the welfare of the police, as it were. Is there a celebration today, given the welfare that police officers at every rank are subjected to? Any of you?
I think more about, besides the celebration, this is the time to reflect for every stakeholder. Let me use an analogy here. I went to a certain farm and the receptionist, I think she had a bad day or that kind of thing. So she gave me this very lousy attitude. Now I know the proprietor of the farm. I could have gotten this girl into trouble because I'm thinking, look, you've got a job to do. I don't care what's happening at home. So now when I come in and you give me this very lousy attitude, it is not tenable. It's not acceptable, you know. But, you know, I thought about it. I engaged her a little bit and I found out, you know, she was going through a lot. And I cut her some slack. Could that be why oftentimes they're not, many of our police officers act the way they do? You know, they're living in tenement structures. Their pay comes very late. It's a niggardly one for that matter. They are in very disturbing conditions, and maybe that would explain why they would behave the way they do. Not that it's justifiable, but it's just a time to reflect, you know, for everybody that is involved, you know. How can we do all this? What are the challenges there are? Leave alone just the confrontation between the police and the general public, but internally, if you want the police to do a much better job, you have got to facilitate them better. You've got to make sure that their standards are something to write home about. That and we need to see a total revamp of that if the police is going to get better, really, not just talking about tear gas and so on.
Yeah, thank you very much. Certainly, it's been a very interesting scenario where we've got to discuss the police, its welfare, the police, its reaction and action towards the people it's supposed to protect and serve, as well as looking down the tremendous history, or should I say, that heritage coming in 100 years down the road. We'd never have thanked you better, Joe.
Thank you.
We'll be back with Simon Says. Many a time, people ask, has the police lived up to their expectation? We all expect something from the police. But have we ever thought for a moment what the police expects of us? Yes, they may be draconian in your view, but are you making the situation easier for them? If you're involved in brigandage, if you're involved in all this ruckus that goes about, you expect to do it without some kind of repression coming in from the powers that be mandated to calm you down? Or have we long forgotten that in enjoyment of our rights, we must know that our enjoyment stops at that point when we begin to infringe on the rights of others. But that is always a delicate balance, and it's an infinite for perfection. I do not know of any society which has been able to achieve that tremendous balance, perhaps in heaven, where neither you or I have been, only maybe in our dreams. As the police celebrates 100 years and promising all this sort of transformation and hoping to make it even a much better police force coming in for the future to meet the future challenges, we as a people also need to look into our conduct and see how much support we give this very vital institution. It is a thought that we both can have throughout this whole new month of October as we go on our business. Otherwise, have a wonderful morning and thanks for watching in the big story. More quality programming does continue at morning at NTV. That is something you certainly cannot afford to miss, not for anything. It's a Friday. Go enjoy your weekend and, of course, stay safe enough so that you're able to watch us Monday when we return same time for even a more interesting conversation and discussion.
You're watching Morning at NTV with Simon Nutty, Mabel KB Runji, and Brian Mulundo.
Look at all the juices that are in there, and that is what I'm looking for. My goodness, look at that.
They say east or west, home is best. The Property Show decodes the country's opaque property market, from the simple bungalows to the marble luxurious palaces. Enjoy a new world of interior and exterior designing and construction tips. Keep updated with the market trends. Don't miss this exciting real estate experience. The Property Show. Coming soon on NTV, Sundays at 7:30 p.m.
Entertainment program.
Log in for the glitz and glamour of Kampala's most flamboyant people and events.
It's my time.
I'm here today for Coco Fingers video shoot.
Big up NTV. Thanks for the support. Log in. New one all the runs is Coco Kasta.
You have a problem with it?
No, I ain't got no problem.
You don't use my mic, man. This is exposed mic.
I got deal with you personally.
XFB, it's officially back. Yeah, I'm in this heat with cats. It's what we do, baby. Put UG on the map. Now come my woe. Now come my woe. Now come my woe. Now come my woe. Hey.
Tadi Muganda yagala munne kututumuka abanyakole mwe yagali de mu Kampala abaji okulonda mwafuna mu bibanja
You're going to start paying for watching Exposed.
Anya ensonga zino nange Farida nakazwa buli lunaku okuva sawa satu okutuka sawa nya ezokumacha tasobwa mwasiza mtia.
on the next episode brought to you by
Orange is the number one internet provider, giving you the fastest internet speeds everywhere.
Tuli wakati wensi yona tuli mu northern hemisphere, I decided here atene southern hemisphere miles wa miti kona ne NTV sawo nyane chitundu twegatte ko ngatukulete the fear alongside boyfriend manager MC Katsinga watoja sepo. Tuina manafu abe masaka angabali ya kasenti bali ya mu city ya Los.
Watching Morning at NTV with Simon Kasiate, Mabel Kebirunji, and Brian Mulondo.
Ugandans will say this is indeed a Bima, Be My Wife, but it actually stands for Bavarian Motor Works. And today we look at the history and the detail involved in the BMW. My name is Brian. This is Everyday Life with us. Let me just have a cruise of this machine and you will understand what I'm talking about.
Did you know this? Mm-hmm. Now this is an ultimate sports car. If you love muscle, if you love the sound of an engine, I'm sure Brian, you felt it.
I yes, love this 3.2 thing. You meters, know, the, yeah. The car I drive, I won't even say it on national TV, but yeah. I drive it. It's a nice car. Eh?
That's right.
But this is really awesome.
Yeah, sure. And if you look at it, I'm sure they have probably captured the headlights. Actually, it's inspired by a tiger look. I mean, you just need to play it in your head. Mm-hmm. So if you look, if you imagine the meanness of a tiger when it's just about to pounce.
To pounce on its
prey. Exactly. Now that's what you get out of a Z4.
Wow.
Yeah, so...
Okay, let's just get into the interior and check some of this stuff. Okay, I'll ask my cameraman to come and take a look at this beautiful stuff, and you'll help us explain first. I was impressed. First of all, it has a sweep.
It means it's keyless, first entry.
What did you say?
It's keyless entry. Now, uh-huh. You actually don't need to enter this car like a physical key, like many of our cars, mm-hmm. like your Gaia or any other form of car. Mm-hmm. And also, you actually don't need a key to exactly start it. You only use that button to get it going.
So what is this? Is this to engage the system?
And that's right.
Because this is the only thing I have that's representing, you know.
So that is merely a modulator. You simply need to... of course, the car needs to get... when I talk about a modulator, I'm just saying, you know, it needs to get some form of ignition.
Ignition. That
it's an ignition of an ignition. But actual ignition of the engine would be by the start button. Many cars, I think this age obviously have that feature.
All right.
Yes.
Now, this is the modulator. You call it a modulator. Just take a look at where it's going. Right here. And then fix it in. And the system is on. All right. And you set the car here. I don't know if Josh can get this, but then this is where, okay, right there. The stop. And boom, it's on.
That's right.
All right, tell us about the other features that are...
Obviously, as you can see, it has Triptronic gear lever. Mm-hmm. So which means unlike in many cars, mm-hmm. What happens is you have to manually shift the gears into one to the from one level to the other.
Yes.
Now, something you just you merely tap like that and then it kicks in.
Not this.
Yeah, of course. It's
a fluid, system.
You know what they usually say about a BMW is that it's made for the driver. So it's for the pleasure of driving, the sheer driving pleasure. That usually is the tagline. Now, when you compare it to obviously the investments in technology come in recent times, and especially with in most German cars you'll find them, but many of the whole thing about BMW is they invest extremely heavily on research and development, and as such they definitely initiate lots of technologies.
Well, if you're just joining us, I am here, let me just show some swag here, the Serena, and enjoying this beautiful Beamer, and we're taking a look at what the camera, the car is. Does it even have sensors? All this stuff. Now, you talked about the keyless, activation system, the engaging of the gear. I see the what do you call it?
This is literally your handbrake.
The handbrake is just a piece of.
That's right.
Take a look at this, man. This is beautiful. Wow. All right. All this. The roof. Where do I engage the roof?
If you need to, if you want to lift the roof, right now it's low. There's a button over here. Mm-hmm. You simply need to press it continuously, and then you can see what happens. Mm-hmm. It converts itself into a hardtop saloon. That's exactly how it works.
Right.
Yeah. So on obviously. Weather changes in weather must be anticipated, so it cannot be full time. Yeah, and in many cars you'll notice that there is that do not have hard tops, then there's a cloth that you have to put up, and it takes a lot of effort.
Yeah,
everything else is electronic in this car.
Wow.
Yeah, that's right.
Let me just put it down.
Yeah.
So it's the same thing.
It's use the other button to just continuously press it down.
All right.
Yeah. First it will bring window.
Beautiful car, this.
Yeah.
Beautiful car. Wow. Awesome. Now, get a piece like this. How do I get it? Where do I get it? Aren't they costly?
Well, this definitely will set you back quite a bit. But they are available. If you want to buy a car, dealers in Uganda, so you definitely can buy one without me having to specify any particular one, because I don't work or vouch for anyone. Yeah, but definitely it should be able to say, and this is something you have to be ready for, upwards of anything depending on many variances that come into play when you're buying a car. Mm-hmm. Are you buying it new, slightly used? But you need between 80,000 and 80,000 US and 100,000 US dollars.
And you get yourself this beautiful one.
Right.
I'm sitting in the Beamer
Z4.
Yeah. Now, most of us have life. That's not the name of the car. The company that makes these cars is Korean Motor Works, and it was started in 1917. So, here at Morning at NTV, we're taking you into Beamers. You are going to have an that will showcase.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, so what we're saying is to be able to celebrate BMW engineering. And BMW, like for anybody who's owned a BMW, it's like a religion. Of course, there are many beautiful cars, I don't doubt, but once you have a BMW in your stable, a passion thing, not just a tool for moving from point A to point B. Right. And the world over, in many countries, there are BMW club. So Uganda, unfortunately, is still in the process of establishing a BMW club. There are efforts in that direction, and a major step towards that direction. Now, the sense of a BMW club is just to create a forum, virtual or in real sense, where BMW owners compare notes. If you want to sell your BMW, you're having problems with a certain part, you need to soup it up, like folks say around here, then where would you get such? Look at this car right there. It has what is called angel lights. Now, if the lights are on, there's that ring around it. Mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily come, of course, for the Z comes, it comes with an initial design. However, with cars like the 3 Series, the 1 Series, and you know, the other 5 Series, it comes with angel lights. For example, if you need angel lights, you just need to get into this forum and ask, okay, get angel lights, you know,
right.
Then it becomes really easy for everyone. So what we're saying on 4th, that BMW owners, mm-hmm. but you don't necessarily have to have a BMW to attend this.
You can come because you want to be inspired. Like,
exactly.
No, I'm inspired.
Yeah,
maybe I'll put the sign of a BMW and come.
Yeah, yeah. So
thank you so much, man, for joining us.
Sure.
How much is it? What do we need to be a part of it?
Well, the event is mm-hmm. 10 o'clock and close at 6:30. It's a car show, so there's going to be a lot of BMWs at the event. Imagine how that would
yeah.
all the world together, and this car and a lot more of this nature would be there. By the way, people don't notice, but have really the 850, which is an extremely rare model. Region in East Africa, there are only 2 models. One is in Nairobi and the other one is here.
Right.
Only one. So Uganda is tough when it comes to BMWs,
yeah.
which is why we need to move to the next level.
Awesome.
Now, so the event is on Saturday, Allegiance Rugby Grounds, gates open at 10 o'clock. Tickets are in advance for mm-hmm. 20,000. At the gate, there will be 30,000.
Okay.
So anybody who wants to get tickets, you can go into our Facebook
the tickets.
Yeah, and get the tickets.
So much,
okay.
Man. Can I just keep this okay until the show ends? Eh?
It's just, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Take your time. Knock yourself out.
Well, it's a Beers and Beers event. It's happening on Saturday, tomorrow, and it's going to be at Legends Club. So go there, and if you want to be inspired, you can own this fine piece of machine. It's definitely luxury and comfort. Okay. So grab yourself one, and tickets, advance tickets you had are available. Get also be tickets, and this is what Morning at NTV is about. Now, the lovers of books, those that read books, have been exposed to some great writers. Now, this person this time who's joining us in Uganda to have great minds this time around, and joining me is Julian Subuga, who is the head of business sales at MTN Uganda. Morning.
Morning, Brian.
I have read some of his books,
yes.
But one of the books that my colleague and I are reading is called Think on These Things. Well, all of us have read something from this gentleman.
Yeah.
Tell us about what he's going to do with Uganda.
This time, John is going to present on Learn and Lead. It's called L2, and that is what the whole world knows about it.
Mm-hmm.
But in Uganda, it's going to be aired through a simulcast. That is the transmission that you guys use on TV,
mm-hmm.
but this time we are bringing it through technology, the
mm-hmm.
internet. It will be in Munyonyo.
Mm-hmm.
But to come back to John Maxwell,
yeah,
he's a leadership expert. He's been named as the best leader and expert for the last 6 years consecutively. In Uganda, we have an opportunity to learn and hear about things that leaders learn all the time, because
right.
that's what it is.
Yeah.
You keep learning as a leader. There's no end to learning.
Right.
Yes.
You know, I'm aware that he's going to do that across 35 countries.
Yes.
Is he going to be speaking to 35 countries at the same time?
Yes, he will. He will, because this is all aired and transmitted through the internet
mm-hmm.
to all the different locations. It's actually 300 locations across
wow.
the world. But he will be at a place in Atlanta, and that's the live speech,
mm-hmm.
and the rest of us shall hear from him. Uganda is just one of the lucky countries in Africa, by the way. And I think and believe that everybody should have this opportunity to be there and enjoy.
How did MTN get Maxwell on board? You know, okay, we know you guys are part of big things always. Yeah, how did you start this partnership?
And yes, you say it well. You say we are part of the big things and we pride in big things. MTN is actually partnering with Solutions Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Solutions Africa is a partner for John Maxwell in Uganda.
Okay.
And that's how we came into this partnership. So we are the technology to deliver that service into Munyonyo here in the country. And I want everybody to be there and just see how MTN technology can actually serve
mm.
such opportunities and events for them.
Mm.
John is actually going to share this with 2 other world-renowned
yeah.
speakers.
Mm.
The Kaplan. Linda is one of the best marketing gurus in town. When I say town, I mean America, and I believe
back in our village in the U.S.
Yeah, back in our village in the U.S. And then we have Tim Sanders. Tim Sanders is a former Yahoo a director. That guy and creativity are one and the same. If God had to do something about creativity, he would ask Tim.
Yeah.
And I think you guys who are in advertising, you guys who are in the media, need to be there
to
just
be there.
See what Tim is going to share with you.
How can we be there? How
you
can we be a part of it?
You need to pay 250,000 shillings,
mm-hmm.
Uganda shillings, and you'll be at the event.
Mm-hmm.
You'll get yourself the same message that is going to be aired. You'll get a leadership message from Tim, and then you'll get a certificate that can actually continue your professional
It's good
excellence.
Stuff for the CV.
Very,
yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very, very good.
Well, that's John C. Maxwell. Please join MTN at, that is on
The
10th of October,
yes.
2014. We'll be, of course, updating you and giving you more details about this event as the week. But, of course, that's MTN, man, everywhere you go. To all readers of these books, you must attend that event. Come back. We'll be talking sports. Bima, stay with us.
You're watching Morning TV with Simon Kasiate, Mabel KB Runji, and Brian Munundo.
This is the story of a forbidden love and a curse. Raised away from the curse, Solana Rangel returns to uncover his roots.
Solana! Those lands are mine. They're mine. I want those papers here. Look, in my hand. I hope he goes from the hospital to his grave. The big ones.
I'm right here. Come on.
What?
Dad! Dad, please stop it! Solana!
He is a brave and strong man, but he couldn't resist Estella's charms. A beautiful, mysterious woman who fights over Solano's love with Manuela, daughter of powerful Max Martinez.
No hard feelings, but Solano and I will get married.
Congrats.
But she keeps a secret in the past.
I don't want to be present. I don't want to be here when it takes place.
Solano!
The curse will be fulfilled. Her real name is Estrella Karu. And her destiny is to fulfill the curse. Destiny.
As we celebrate 8 years, NTV breaks new ground with NTV Mobi. You can now watch the news and any of your favorite shows anytime, anywhere. And to celebrate with us, text the unique code, which will appear on your screen, to Codra 6 to enter a draw and stand a chance to win loads of gift hampers. And it even gets better. We have a grand prize of 100 motorbikes to give out in 100 days. NTV, we are definitely turning on your world.
Showbiz. Hey, when I'm in Uganda, I only listen to DJ Baby Love.
When you're dancing at the light, girl, work out, your body no fly, your fingernail, them no fever.
You have a problem with it?
No, I ain't got no problem.
You don't use my mic, man. This is exposed mic.
I go deal with you personally.
Except B, it's officially back. Yeah, I'm in this heavy with cats. It's what we do, baby, put UG on the map. Now come my woe, now come my woe, now come my woe, now come my woe, hey.
Tadi Muganda ya gala mune kututumuka. Aba nyankole mwe ya gali demokampala. Aba jokulonda mwafuna mumi banja.
Bravo.
I'm that dude, don't they come and love it.
You're going to start paying for watching Exposed.
I wasn't born last night. I know these hoes ain't right.
On the last episode,
brought to you by
Orange is the number one internet provider, giving you the fastest internet speeds everywhere.
Burn it up.
They've had their struggle throughout the competition to change their lives. They were originally 16 individuals, but now they have been cut down to 10. They've been tested, both mentally and physically, to make it this far. Now, the million-dollar question is, who wins it? The grand finale show is on this Saturday. Burn It Up, transforming lives.
Orange is the number one internet provider. You can have the best internet experience in Uganda. Simply dial *133# to buy an internet bundle. Today changes with Orange.
You brand to Kasingura. Have
you? I'm starting it.
Well, it's morning at MT. I'm picking this Muchiga from the gate.
I have refused.
You're not coming out.
I'm doing the spot for me, so you can start. I'm okay.
Good to go. Okay, let me stand. Let's put some swag.
Yeah.
What's up, man?
Oh, good, man. What's happening, man?
You're doing well.
Yeah, so can take you. What do you want to know about my ride? I'm here to take you throughout it, so if you want to know anything about it, I'm cool with it. I'm not admiring footballers no more since I've sat in the I've sat in the car they drive. I'm not admiring them anymore.
Well, if you're just joining us, it's morning at NTV, and we have just gotten you a sample of the Bima here. It's Bimas and Beers on Saturday at Legends Club, and 20,000, of course, advance tickets, and 30,000 at the gate. So if you own a Bima, if you're a lover of Bimas, please feel free, join the guys. If you do a Chikumi, put on a Bima sign and go there and join the guys, all right? Now joining me is a Mchiga I picked from the gate. Morning, man.
Morning.
How you doing?
No bad, how you?
Let's first talk some real tight spot here before I get
it's
into
it. It's a shame there's no BMW in F1. Others would have tried this weekend.
Right.
Yeah. It's ours for me.
Let's talk about rally first. He has opted out of the Zion Independence Rally, Mubiru. Now, is it down to Robert and Sebuguzi to tussle it up?
It has to be because I think it's been the closest to Ronald Sebuguzi in terms of competition. Of course, with all due respect to all the other guys, of course, Omar Mayanja, who did well in the Pearl of Africa Rally, Pole Pole, and a couple of other guys. But I think Duncan Chikankani would have brought a totally different feel to the rally if he had been involved. Unfortunately, he's going to be driving in the Kisumu Rally in Kenya. He feels that probably he should be driving locally here because he's been doing that for some time now. He did well in, I think it was in TZ, Rwanda. Now this is the second time actually he's driving in Kenya because there was a safari, now Kisumu. So it feels probably it's better for him to expose himself, probably drive with the better drivers and improve. But back home here, I think the Independence Rally, you have to feel Ronald Sebuguzi starts as a firm favorite to win this one without respect to all the other guys that are going to be part of this.
Right. Before you have the Zone 5, where our teams did a tremendous job.
Absolutely.
Who, you know, do you think Ndeja will kick the ground running?
First of all, for the fans, we've been used to the highest level of basketball within the region. And, the likes of even our national team, totally different team, with Rwanda, Egypt, Somalia. Now we come back home where there are a few things that are lacking in our game.
Right.
We'll bear the pain
and
forget about Zone 5 because I'm already missing it by the way because the basketball was high class. But back home here, it's going to be Ndeji up against KIU. It should be an interesting game. Struggled this season. You feel they could have added one or two things about their game, given how they performed well last season. But they haven't done that. So you feel KIU have been the better played a wonderful game against Warriors. That's the best I've seen them play. When they beat up on passing game, they've always been a good defensive team, but they've always lacked that spark on the offense. But this time around against Warriors, they did well. So we can only wait and see what comes. Well, I think they should be favorites against Ndeji. If they can play just half of what they did against Warriors, then they should be able to beat up on Ndeji. But you never know. This break probably could have given
time. Right. Well, the Uganda Premier League is on. And some people are still saying, why are we calling our league Uganda Premier League? It's, well,
I mean,
we have to deal with that.
One.
But will SC Villa You are a spoiled Kigonyas week, who had a very beautiful game the other day.
Absolutely. Kigonyas, one of, I think he's the first goalkeeper. The couple of years, Uganda footballer keeper converted a free kick. Mm-hmm. Mathias Chigonya was the first I saw do that. And he converted a brilliant free kick. And not only scoring, but a goal that won the game for Bright Stars when they're playing against, which team are they playing against? That I've actually forgotten. When they're playing against Bidco, which is Bull FC. A brilliant free kick. Now, they highlight the media's focus has been on Villa because they sacked the manager just after three games. Steven Bogere had won twice and only lost one against Police, which took Police to the top of the table. Joined top stars. Now it's Sam Simba in. He brings a lot of course, media attention. Loves talking. He's got a couple of things he always says that catches the media. But a couple of people also disappointed that Steven Bogere had to be sacked in that
through the papers, yeah.
And they were talking about him going for a coaching course in South Africa. The guy didn't even know about it. He got to know about it through the media. So that means that can only be a lie that you're telling us you're taking the guy to South Africa. You should have known about it long before. But anyway, Sam Simba kicks off today with a very tough game against URA in Mitiana. They are home. They should be able to beat up on URA. But remember, URA for me are still a very big side in football. So you feel Simba will have to pull out, I think, all his best tactics to beat up on URA. It should be a tricky game for him.
Well, let me. Don't embarrass me.
The beauty about these cars, if you fail to open, you just jump in. I think it's a trick.
And you see some of these petrol stations can't fuel my car.
Yeah,
I have to pause.
It's the first time.
Speaking of cars, when we talk about Formula One, the Typhoon, hopefully, chance does Hamilton have?
A bigger chance, as one to imagine, because he's leading the championship, first of all, after being behind for a couple of, I think, races, with Nico Rosberg leading there. He was second in the first practice session. Nico Rosberg was fastest, but all counts for nothing. The most important bit about F1 starts at the qualifying, where you start. If you start as number one on the grid, then it gives you a lot of chance for you to go. Suzuka is a very brilliant track, I think. So many drivers enjoy it. A very fast track. It can be, for some spells, tricky. Some stretches, tough to overcome. So if you give yourself a chance to start number one on the grid, it gives a huge chance to go ahead. And that's what Hamilton always does best. But listen, he's got a big chance, as you would want to imagine. Is Hamilton ready to take a risk? He's leading.
Yeah.
Probably, if he only stays sensible enough, not too... being too aggressive, because he might end up losing goal if you want to be too aggressive. It's only 3 points, because if Nico, for example, won and Hamilton finished second, he would have closed the gap. So I'm sure Hamilton would want Nico as much as he can. The Red Bull have always done well in Japan. Sebastian Vettel has already won there, I think, thrice, if I'm not mistaken. Hamilton has never won there. So I'm sure he'll be raring to go so that he can win something there. So I'd love to think he starts as favorite for me, Hamilton, given the last two races he's won and he's been doing well.
Right. Well, English Premier League, Welbeck did something unexpected. I think I'm starting to love him. But what are the odds that he can do the same at Chelsea?
Scoring a hat-trick? Hell no. No chance. No chance.
Why do you say that?
So with all due respect to what he did in midweek, he's not scored. I would even be impressed if he scored one. Which he can, of course, given the strength. He'll bother that Chelsea defense with his strength and pace, of course, which Arsene Wenger this week called electric sometimes. He says he's always known Welbeck to be fast, but he didn't know he was that electric.
Right.
So he can bother a few in the Chelsea back. John Terry, Gary Cahill, Cesar Azpilicueta, and maybe Branislav Ivanovic. But this is a totally different ball game, I think. Chelsea, top form. They're the most informed Premier League team. They're at the top of the table. They've won all their opening games. So you think Arsenal are going to face their biggest test? Forget about the Man City game. It's going to be their biggest test. Last season, they sank in six. Can they limit that? Can they give themselves a chance? The biggest hope that Arsenal should have going into this game is that Diego Costa played 90 minutes in midweek against Sporting Lisbon.
So he's a bit tired.
Yeah, Mourinho says he cannot play two games in a week. But that's what it seems like. Can he decide to go with Didier Drogba who never traveled to Portugal? Because Didier Drogba has always had a very good record. against Arsenal. I doubt he will do that because I'm sure he knows Diego Costa is his best striker at the moment. He would love to start with the midfields. That's when you think about maybe Loic Remy and maybe even Didier Drogba.
Right.
It's going to be a tough game for the Arsenal, but they've always had the number. Forget about last season. They've always had the numbers to match this Chelsea team. So you never know what they could do, but it's at Stamford Bridge. Anything can happen for me.
Tell us about the other games in Spain and Italy.
First of all, Dortmund have struggled. They're going to play another struggling team in Hamburg, in Germany. Hamburg have started this. They haven't won a single game. They've drawn twice and lost four times in their opening six games. Dortmund have struggled, but you feel this should be a much easier team. But also, sometimes you don't play against such teams. They might decide to kickstart their season when they're playing against you. So I feel, but in Spain, I think the biggest game should be Valencia up against Atletico. Joint top Valencia against alongside Barcelona. They play against an Atletico side. Should be third, I think. They've started the season well. Atletico are going to be really tested. They had to work their socks off against Juventus in midweek. Do they still have enough energy to play and match this Valencia team? Who you'd love to think were well rested. I don't think they were too much bothered about the midweek action.
Right.
So that should be the toughest game. Atletico Valencia, tough one. We can only wait and see what comes out of there.
Right. Well, I fear to. But what is Manu up to this weekend?
Manu plays.